Welcome, Julia, for joining us today. On behalf of the Center for Russian, East European and Eurasian Studies, I'm welcoming everyone here to this talk by my colleague, Julia Obertreis from Germany, from the University of Erlangen. And yeah, I'm really happy it works out. That's one of the big pluses of the pandemic. If there are any pluses, we can have these Zoom lectures and people are still attending, and we also usually have a bigger audience than in life. And it's, yeah, really nice to have you here. Okay, so just a reminder. So this lecture is recorded and also it's live streamed on Facebook, just to make you aware of that. And for after the talk, we have the Q&A button for every participant. So you feel free to send any questions there. And yeah, then we'll have another 40 minutes probably for discussion after the talk. But now, first of all, let me introduce Julia Obertreis. Welcome here at the University of Pittsburgh. Julia Obertreis is professor for modern and East European history at the University of Erlangen-Nürnberg. And she's working on a couple of subjects that are closely related to what our center here at the University of Pittsburgh is doing. So Julia Obertreis has research stress focus on the Russian Empire and the Soviet Union, with a special focus on infrastructures, technology, and here again, the focus is on water infrastructures. So that's, of course, also closely related to environmental history. Other than that, she likes working with the perspectives of global and transnational history. She's also written a couple of articles and contributions in the field of oral history, and not to forget more broadly, cultural and social history of Eastern Europe. Before coming to her current position, she was working, among others, in Freiburg. Her PhD is from the University of the Free University of Berlin. So she wrote a book, which is also available here, The Tears of Socialism, Living in Leningrad Between Everyday Life and Utopia, which came out in 2004 with Berlau Press. This is unfortunately available only in German, but it is available here. Among the other publications, it's a long list, and there's also an English version of her CV on her website. So just to mention a couple of these, Moving Knowledge, the Soviet Union and China in the 20th Century in the journal Comparative, which came out in 2019. Television Beyond and Across the Iron Curtain, an edited volume that came out in 2016. And then there's a whole range of articles and contributions to edited volumes in the field of oral history, Eastern European history and more broadly, and infrastructure and water in Central Asia in special. Yeah, and the most notable book, and that's also the reason why we invited Julia here, is the book that came out just 4 years ago. The book is titled Imperial Desert Dreams, Cotton Growing and Irrigation in Central Asia between 1860 and 1991. So this book is available in English, came out with in Göttingen with V&R Unipress, and it's available here at the PitCat in the online format. So feel free to look into that. Most recent major contribution, which is also what in Germany is called an habilitation. So basically the second book after the PhD. Okay, so as I said, we'll have the talk first, and after that we'll have a Q&A session with our participants here. Feel free to send all your questions on the Q&A, I'll moderate it. And yeah, welcome Julia, and the floor is yours.
Thank you very much. Hello everybody. It's afternoon here, but I still can say good morning to you, I guess. Thank you for your kind introduction. I will basically present some results and some insights into the book that Jan mentioned, Imperial Desert Dreams. At the end, I would like to briefly present a new project that is just beginning. It's also about water in Central Asia, but with a different focus. Well, my research was about irrigation, cotton growing, and environmental questions in Central Asia to be more precise, in Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan. And here you see a typical picture of one of the many irrigation canals that brings water to the land and creates blossoming gardens and blossoming landscapes. Contents of my today's presentation, I will shortly introduce the region, but very briefly, then I will talk about these blossoming oases, topos that came up in the imperial period before 1917, and then went on smoothly into the Soviet period. I will then go to the post-war period, post 1945, and the grand schemes in irrigation and cotton growing. I will address water and cotton problems, ecological problems that became economic problems too. And the eco-criticism that I found in the sources for Central Asia, for the Soviet period. And I will end with the conclusion and an outlook to the new project. So let's begin with a short introduction. This is a survey map of the Aral Sea Basin. And as you know, the Aral Sea has mostly gone in the last decades. You can see here this yellow line. This was the Aral Sea level in 1977. This is the rests of it in 2013. Since then, it has changed again. But this is known as one of the biggest ecological catastrophes in the Soviet Union and maybe even globally. This siltation of the Aral Sea was one of the departing points, so to say, for my project. You can also see the two countries that I'm most concerned with, Uzbekistan and Turkmenistan, and you see two big rivers. And most of the irrigation water comes from these really big rivers, the Syrdarya and the Amudarya, which have flown into the Aral Sea, but then came to stop before it because much of the water was spent on irrigation. And irrigation systems have existed long ago in this region for centuries. They are basically three-step systems which take the water from the big rivers, then transport them via main canals to lesser canals, and finally with small canals onto the fields. This is a very general description, of course, but it, I think it holds true for most of the regions which are in different, of course. Approaches and aims of the project. I was starting with James C. Scott's High Modernism. I think some of you probably know it, and wanted to put it in historical perspective. The title of his book is Seeing Like a State, how certain schemes to improve the human condition have failed. And he writes about making societies and nature legible for planners and for governments, and how this produces a disrespect, so to say, a neglect of local knowledge of certain local conditions that are not taken into account when big schemes of planning and politics are applied. James Scott is not an historian, and I wanted to try to put his concept to a concrete historical material. I have combined cultural history with imperial and colonial or post-colonial history. This is not unusual, of course, but less common is the combination with agricultural history or rural history and infrastructure history. This is a term that is not, I think, very well established yet in English, but in German you have the corresponding term Infrastrukturgeschichte, and you have a lot of quite interesting theoretical methodological literature on this. My approach was to trace the main ideas for the modernization of irrigation and cotton growing through the late imperial and the Soviet periods in a rather long-term approach from the late imperial period, from the 1860s, 1880s, and through the end of the Soviet period in 1991. And as you well know, irrigation and cotton growing are two very important subjects in this region. So I wanted to show which ideas existed to modernize these sectors and overcome the alleged backwardness of the region and of the people living there. The blossoming oasis. I'll start with a quotation from an author who wrote about the geographical outline of Turkestan, southern Central Asia in 1893. As is well known, the boundless dead steppes of Central Asia are enlivened by small but blossoming and fertile oases. The general appearance of the surfaces of this land in regard to culture may be summarized in a few words. Terrible fertility, in Russian, strashnaya plodorodie, on the one hand, and absolute infertility, absolutnaya bezplodie, on the other. This is a quite typical description of the time. Most Russian language authors have described the steppe and desert landscapes as being dull, monotonous, even sad, empty, barren, and so on. And they juxtapose this very much to the green, fertile oasis. It seems that green was for them, for the Russians, something familiar that they looked out for and that they evaluated very positively. And they departed from the thought that irrigation water would have a strong cultivating effect on the region in a double sense. It would bring culture in the agricultural sense to new areas, but also culture to the region in a social cultural sense to the people. So it would not only cultivate the desert and steppe lands, but also the people who live there. And this thought is very typical for all kinds of authors who write in that period, in the late imperial period. So be it geographers, be it just travelers, be it imperial officials, they all have these same ideas, more or less. Another idea was to stimulate cotton growing. And it has often been described that, in literature that allegedly cotton growing, or the aim to grow more cotton, was one of the motifs for the Russian Empire to conquer Central Asia, southern Central Asia, Turkestan. But this is not really the case. In fact, the ideas were different at that time. In the 1860s, it was more about commerce, about trading, and so on. It was also a bit about gold and other minerals, but it was not yet about cotton. But when the region was conquered afterwards, so to say, the interest of the center of Petersburg in cotton was growing. And there were agricultural stations and different attempts to enhance cotton growing, for example, the introduction of American cotton seeds and other things. And indeed, there was a cotton boom. In the later 19th century and early 20th centuries. But that was not so much a result of state politics, but it was more a result of commercial tendencies and the interest of the farmers to earn more money. Here on this picture, this is a very typical colonial, so to say, picture from this period and from the Russian context. You see Russian language geographer Alexander Voyekov, who wrote a lot about water and climate in Central Asia. And you see him in mid cotton field near Kokand in a publication from 1914. And he's the one in the middle, who's, you see in profile, who's dressed entirely in white and I interpret this as a very colonial appearance, this white dress, you know, this European appearance in the middle of these cotton fields. And it was a symbol of the striving for augmenting cotton growing. And now we jump to the Soviet period. This is the 1930s. And you see Lenin and Stalin, sculptures of Lenin and Stalin sitting in midst, again, of a cotton richdom, cotton paradise, so to say. You see cotton plants in the foreground, and in the background, you see these packages of cotton with numbers written on them. These are the harvest results, the recent harvest results, how many tons of cotton have been produced. And this picture is showing the central hall of the Uzbek Pavilion at the All Union Agricultural Exhibition in Moscow in 1993. It's a forerunner of the WDNH big exhibition that was is very famous in the afterwar period. And here it was about agriculture, and every Soviet republic had its own pavilion, and the Uzbek pavilion was, as you see, centered on the subject of cotton. And in my book, I argue that this the Uzbek nation building and this cotton symbolism, that they merged, and that cotton became a centerpiece of, so to say, of the national Uzbek Soviet identity. Another cotton picture from the same year. It's entitled Cotton Harvest, and it's taken by the famous Soviet photographer Max Benson. And I chose it because here you see the masses of cotton produced, and this was a real cotton cult emerging at this time in the 30s, when the collectivization of agriculture was pushed through against much resistance. As a result, cotton was being established as a kind of monoculture in many regions. And secondly, I chose it because here you see this idea of, you know, the natives being from a different world, being from a backward world, this horse carriage, and how they, nevertheless, they, despite these backward conditions, they managed to produce much, much cotton for the Soviet center. So if you compare the imperial pre-1917 and the Soviet post-1917 periods, you see that these ideas of producing much cotton, enhancing cotton growing, and enhancing and modernizing irrigation systems for this purpose, and also the ideas of the backwardness of the region that has to be lifted to another level of development, that they persisted. Of course, you had a different context in the Soviet period, different politics, different ideology, but there are these strong continuities as well. We are moving on to the afterwar period. And the grand schemes in irrigation and cotton growing, because up to this point, there was much talk about cotton growing and much talk about modernizing irrigation in the imperial as well as in the early Soviet period. But then in the end, not very much was really built, erected, modernized. And the real push for modernization is only in the afterwar period, and even after Stalin's death. So you cannot say that Stalinism was the high time of modernization. Stalinism was, as we know, the high time of terror. But the real modernization in terms of really changing irrigation systems and really changing the fields to introduce more machines and so on was only beginning from the 50s. And as a symbol of this, I show you this picture. It's from an illustrated history of irrigation that was published in 1959, and that specifically addresses the history of irrigation of Uzbekistan. It's a painting in this book. It's called Steppe is Calling, Steppe Zavyot. And you see two young people, presumably from Central Asian origin. The man is the, so you say, the dominant figure, pointing to the future, pointing to the vast landscape. The woman is more shy, I would say. They have kind of komsomol clothing from the youth organization of the Communist Party. And in the background, you see an instrument which is measuring the land in order to irrigate it or settle it. And also, it's not very easy to see it here, but there are some like tents in the background on the right side where people are living. And this is reflecting the Virgin Lands campaigns of the 50s, which Nikita Khrushchev, the new general party secretary, became famous for. They are usually associated not with Uzbekistan, but with Siberia, but they took place in Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan as well. The idea is that especially young people come in thousands to these virgin lands and in a big campaign where everybody is happily participating, they are constructing settlements, laying out irrigation systems or plowing the fields and make these fields, this agriculture serving men. And with this very intense extension of the irrigation systems came about. And this is a typical picture of how an irrigation canal was built, the covering of the ground. You see these big concrete shields that were laid out. This is a rather big canal. There were smaller ones as well. And you see the big machine that is doing the work. You have other pictures from that time, from the 50s, 60s, where you see juxtaposed the old way of building irrigation canals with all manual work, the native people, so to say, building these with rather primitive instruments. And then you have this new Soviet modern way with big machines doing all the work and humans relieved from this work. In fact, in the 30s and 40s, all the canal building work was still done manually, and there were almost no machines. Machines were really only introduced from the 50s. Another machine, this is a cotton harvester as a symbol of progress in agriculture. And you see the big, big cotton fields, very rich blossoms, and even two of these heavy machines. They were very much used for propaganda, these pictures. And sometimes you even have a young girl sitting on such a big machine that was like double progress because you have the machine and then you have a woman driving the machine and mastering the technical things. In fact, women were doing mostly all the manual work because most of it, of the cotton harvesting, still remained manual work. Men were mostly more into the technical and managing things. And the big machines were like very representative on these pictures, but in reality, they were not really working in Central Asia because the fields were too small. There was not enough technical knowledge to really maintain these big machines. The same is true for tractors as well, that were introduced in masses in the 30s. So we have a lot of different kind of problems with the machines, but for propaganda, they were very important. This was a very interesting moment and important moment, this talk that you see here, for the people who were engaging in developing the so-called Hungary Step. That's an area in Uzbekistan and Kazakhstan. In Uzbekistan, it's situated not far away from Tashkent, from the capital to the southwest. And the man on the right who is explaining something to Brezhnev with the sunglasses, is Viktor Duchovny. And he's an important man in my book because he was an engineer coordinating the works in the Hungary Step. And he was also a collector of memories from the Hungary Steppers, as they called themselves, Golodnostetsi. And he has also written extensive memoirs himself, which I analyzed. And he writes that these visits from first Khrushchev and then Brezhnev to the Hungary Step were very important moments, not just in a symbolic sense that they paid attention to this region, but also in the very concrete sense of deciding about things on the spot. So when these high representatives of Soviet power came, there were vivid discussions with the experts on the spot, and they were really making decisions. And here it's about drainage. So if you irrigate, you usually have to build drainage as well. Otherwise you will have problems. In the 60s in the Soviet Union, there were intense discussions about drainage. Was it needed or was it not needed? And if it was needed, then which kind of drainage? And here they are just discussing these things. And I think Viktor Duchovny chose this picture and is probably very proud of this picture because it shows him engaging in this discussion with Brezhnev himself. But this mostly male society of the Hungary Steppers, consisting of engineers, of Soviet officials, technical experts, agricultural experts, was a mixed society in the ethnic or national sense. So you had Duchovny came from a Ukrainian Jewish family, and you see on the picture here also Sarkisov, who was an Armenian, and you have Russians, other Ukrainians, but also quite a lot of people from Uzbekistan and Central Asia itself. And I found that this much-cited friendship of the peoples, Druzhba Narodov in the Soviet Union, that it was real to some extent, and that they really shared their everyday life and their working life. I spoke about drainage. The lack of drainage was one of the basic problems of the extension of irrigation. But there was another problem, which I referred to in the beginning, the situation of the Aral Sea. And here you have a quote from Viktor Yaruchenko, member of the expedition Living Water, Zhivaya Vada, about Muinak in Karakpay, Pakistan. This is just the region adjacent to the Aral Sea in the south in Uzbekistan, and he was getting there in 1978 with about 15 people, Central Asians and people from Moscow, visiting the region in order to sort out how big the environmental problems were, and they wanted just to study the situation with water there. 7th of June, 1978, towards the evening, we arrived in Muinak. Step, boring, flat step. Little houses, bachans, this is sand hills between the houses. The sea, the Aral Sea, that has withdrawn far from here. A four-story building is half covered by sand. On the fourth floor is the post office. We conduct a round table in the district committee of the party. So you have this 78 quote that shows that at this time, Muinakbot was already half buried in sand. So this is a document of the rapid siltation process that was going on, the Aral Sea withdrawing from his coastal lines, and the regions at the former coast being more and more buried under sand. And you see this process here. I think these pictures may be familiar. 1977, 1989, 2006. So you see it's a very rapid process of siltation. And it's mostly, I would say, almost completely due to the irrigation and the oversized usage of water in agriculture, but also in industry. You had an overall water scarcity by the mid 1970s already. It was getting worse and worse. You had the salinization of waters and soils. It's also a consequence of excessive irrigation and the lack of drainage. And you have the groundwaters rising, which is worsening salinization. So these are very typical problems for irrigation areas that come up in almost every country where irrigated agriculture exists. But the question always is to which extent. And these problems, they got really bad during the 70s and 80s. And they were not just ecological problems, they also became economic problems. Because these problems affected the cotton plants and the cotton yields. So you had a stagnation in cotton yields, although in Soviet thinking and propaganda and planning culture, cotton yields were to rise and rise and rise. So every year there should be produced more cotton. And in 1980, there was a big breakthrough when 6 million tons of cotton were produced in Uzbekistan alone. Uzbekistan was by far the biggest producer of cotton in the Soviet Union and one of the biggest in the world already. That was celebrated with poems and songs and so on. But in reality, at this time already, much of the production figures were fake, and they were already stagnating and going down. What to do against these problems? Many Central Asians, including ordinary people, officials, experts, were dreaming of the diversion of Siberian rivers to Central Asia. That was a project that was had its own history and was not really new. But in the 70s, a whole range of institutes began to work on this project very intensely. And you have one little example here, this photograph. It's a model of the end, so to say, of the big canal that was to derive Siberian rivers, the Ob and the Irtysh, and drive their waters over thousands of kilometers to the south and to Central Asia in order to fill up the water reservoirs there. And these projects were stopped in 1986 by Gorbachev. As we know, as far as we know, mostly due to reasons of high costs. So it was just too expensive to build them. Not really for ecological reasons, although for geological, from ecological perspectives, it's of course, it's really a maniac's idea. There was also eco-criticism. So criticism on the grounds of ecological, environmental thinking that was very much progressing in the 1970s in the Soviet Union. And here you have one highlight on this ecological criticism, and it criticizes directly this development of virgin lands that I talked about, and that addresses the development of the Hungary Step as well. And this was the most outspoken citation I could find in the Central Asian press. One of the serious ecological problems of today is the attack on the desert. In conjunction with the development of new areas, the water deficit will rise more and more, end quote. And this may seem not too interesting, but if you know the Soviet context and Soviet rhetoric, I think it's an really interesting quotation, because she talks of ecological problems, serious ecological problems, and combines this with the attack on the desert. And this attack on the desert was a fixed Soviet term to describe the development of desert and steppe regions, this idea of conquering, mastering nature. And also Brezhnev, in his memoirs, who had written about the Vigilance campaign, he also uses this kind of military rhetoric, the attack on the desert. So, and she shows that these two are combined, that this attack on the desert created these serious problems. Another example from this criticism that got more outspoken and broader after 85, after the advent of power of Mikhail Gorbachev. This is Grigory Ivanovich Reznichenko, who was again member of an expedition from Moscow to Central Asia, an expedition of journalists and writers and people interested in environmental things. And he talks to Viktor Duchovny, who I have shown to you in the picture before, talking to Brezhnev. Hasn't there been an alternative to the simple method of raising the quantity of cotton by new hectares of land and new cubic meters of water? Why didn't you, the specialists, propose anything new, progressive? You want to say, Grigory Ivanovich, that you, journalists and publicists, are people of avant-garde views, and we are people of the stagnation time, hotly and quick-temperedly began Duchovny. How long have you worked in Novy Mir? Novy Mir was a Soviet literary journal, very important journal. It will soon be 15 years. That means that you too have participated in the publication of the memoirs of Brezhnev that contained a very positive depiction of the Virgin Land campaign in Kazakhstan. What do you want from us? The talk with Viktor Abramovich followed the principle, you are a fool yourself, sam durak. And it ended on exactly this note. So here you see the critics on the one hand, and on the other hand, people like Viktor Duchovny, who were also called votniki, representatives of the Ministry of Water Management, of the, so to say, conventional Soviet management of water resources and agriculture. A last quote from the critics, this time from a woman, a journalist, Irina Alyabieva. And she was talking here in 89 about the long-term Uzbek party leader Sharaf Rashidov. He had been in power since 1959 and died in the early 80s. And the whole extension of irrigation systems, the development of the Hungary Steppe, were very much connected to his name, because he was like a patron for all these undertakings. And she writes, he, Rashidov, allowed himself to dream about the transformation of 23 million hectares of desert into a blossoming oasis in order to immortalize his name, and wrung out for his dreams billions. Those were the years of the barbaric wastage of water, end quote. So here you have this blossoming oasis again as a false ideal of Soviet policies. And then you have the barbaric wastage of water as an accusation against these votniki, against Rashidov, against the political establishment. I'm coming to the last part, conclusion and outlook. So if you see the Russian pre-1917 and the Soviet periods, you see that they are connected, as I said, by the topos of the blossoming oasis and the idea of cotton autonomy. This was very much a part of propaganda, especially in the 20s and 30s, that the Soviet Union would have to gain cotton autonomy and not be dependent of cotton imports anymore. And officially in the mid 30s, the Soviet Union really became independent of cotton imports. I spoke about James Scott's high modernism. If you look at the whole period, I think the peak of high modernism, of these grand schemes of transforming nature and society, were in the afterwar period, only after Stalin's time in the Khrushchev and Brezhnev periods. There was also this eco-criticism that I talked about. It began in the 1970s, although there were forerunners in the 50s and later. And I wrote even in Central Asia to stress that Central Asia is not really known as a region of dissent in the Soviet context. So there's even a line in a book by Adib Khalid, who writes much about Central Asia, and he writes, there are no Soviet Central Asian dissidents. I don't know if it's true, but at least Central Asia is not really known for protest, you know, of this kind. Some is that dissidents, opinions, and so on. But you can clearly see this eco-criticism in the region. The cotton yields were put in danger and even reduced due to the ecological problems I addressed. But cotton growing continued to be a state-dominated economic sector after 1991. So when Uzbekistan became independent, and up to now, it's a sector where the state very much directs the development, prices for cotton are fixed, people are forced to sow cotton, all kinds of people, like pupils and students and so on, are forced to work on the cotton fields. It's a very problematic sector. This is my new project already. Just today, I received the news that we are getting a bit of money to develop this project further. It's an idea that came up recently. My first experience, so to say, was that I found a book about fountains in the US, mainly, and I was so intrigued by these fountains, the history of fountains, especially in the 20th century, that I decided to do something about this. And then we were discussing this with a colleague from SOAS in London. It's an idea of studying water planning, representation through water, and something that is called imagineering in Tashkent, in Uzbekistan, in the capital, in comparison with Ahmedabad in Gujarat in India. The project partners are Professor Peter Molinka from Development Studies from the SOAS in London, Professor Monika Grubauer from the History and Theory of the City in Hamburg, in Germany, and Dr. Aditya Ramesh, History Environmental Research from the University of Manchester in England. And our idea is to compare these two cities that have very different histories, of course, but also some points in common, for example, the colonial past. To address briefly this concept of imagineering, it somehow combines images and planning and engineering. It combines the creation of urban images and place brands with aspects of materiality. Imagined places can be seen as sites of struggle in which the dreams and interests of some are prioritized over those of others. This is an article by Bücher from 2019, as you see, and we hope to make this productive for our regions. The concrete objects of study are riverfronts, fountains, and artificial lakes in the city. So when I have worked on the countryside with my book Imperial Desert Dreams, but I'm now moving on to study water in the city. And just to give you an idea of what this can be, just two pictures. The above picture, you have a fountain in the shape of cotton in front of the Alisher Navai Theater and Opera in Tashkent. It was erected in 1947. On the other side, you have an artificial lake with a musical fountain in Tashkent City Park, a big area, very modern recreation area that was just created a few years ago in Tashkent. And you have different projects of this kind in Tashkent now, where spaces are totally transformed into this kind of modern recreation zones. And water is always playing an important role in these projects. Yeah, okay, I'll stop here. This is a very short selective bibliography. I thank you for your attention and I'm looking forward to the discussion.
Yeah, thank you, Julia, for presenting this. We're opening up the Q&A now. So for all those of you who have questions, suggestions, please send them on the Q&A. And I guess we'd start with the students who are here also. But we have a first question. So yeah, I'm probably going to read the question. I have a question about the fate of cotton. Once it was delivered to the state, was the cotton industrially clean, turned into thread or cloth in these countries? If not, where was most of the raw cotton sent? Do we have a sense of the amounts that stayed in Central Asia or were sent elsewhere? So Julia, if you can address
that first. Yeah, that's an important question. Most of the cotton was cleaned and dried on the spot, but it was not processed to cloth in Central Asia. And that was one of the big debates that were going on, especially in the afterwar period, because Central Asian planners wanted to have this kind of industry in their republics. But the center was not very willing to allow this. So most of the cotton was transported to Russia to be processed. Before the revolution, it was also going to Poland, the Polish part of the Russian Empire. But afterwards, in the Soviet period, yeah, mostly to Russia, to the big textile plants in central Russia.
Yeah, thank you for asking this question. And directly related to this question, I would also like to ask you about, you mentioned that previously, the global connections that your project also had, cotton growing. I mean, that's not Central Asia is not the only region we have cotton production. And I wanted to ask you about the connections that you can draw maybe between, you know, even this United States and this region in the 19th century. And also, is the region even today still a cotton export region?
Yes, thank you. The USA were very important for Russia and Central Asia because much of the cotton that was used before the conquest of Turkestan came from the US. And then you had the US Civil War in the 1860s. And that was a period when cotton exports from the US dropped significantly. And it was a very crucial period, so to say, for the global cotton connections, because in Russia, as in other countries, people were thinking about, okay, we obviously cannot really rely on American cotton anymore. So we have to spur our own production. And the British did this in India with some success, and the Russians tried it in Central Asia. And this was also a kind of an element of this idea of cotton autonomy I talked about, that writers in the imperial period, they often complained about that it would not be good to spend so much money on foreign cotton, and they had in view, in mind, primarily the American cotton. Sorry. Global Connections. There is a book by Sven Beckert about cotton growing and cotton trade in a global perspective in the 19th century, The Empire of Cotton. And he shows that colonialism, imperial power, and cotton growing are typically closely connected. And you can say that this is true for Russia and Central Asia as well. But in contrast to other regions of the world, there was, as far as we know, there was less coercion. So we don't have reports about, forcing really with brutal force peasants into growing cotton. But it seems to be rather really like more an economic process. People, farmers on the spot, they were paid loans, advances on the cotton harvests, and this made it attractive for them to grow cotton. But then when the Civil War came, the Soviet Civil War from 1918 to 1921, you also saw the downside of this development, because grain imports from Russia were stopped. And then you saw that you cannot eat cotton. This is always the risk. If you don't grow grain, but grow cotton, you must rely on imports. And this led to a mass famine in Central Asia in the early 20s. So yeah, there's a close connection of colonial power and cotton. But Central Asia seems to be a less, less brutal case than when you compare with other world regions.
Okay, thank you. So do we have any more questions? So please send them on the Q&A. And while we are waiting, I have one other question. So you briefly mentioned that cotton growing was also part of, you probably call it a nation building process in the region. And I wanted to ask about a little more detail about this. So how did cotton create, the Uzbek nation? So what was the impact here? I mean, you can see it on the fountain you presented at the very end, that cotton and in the representation of the urban space today seems to be very dominant still. So what is the contribution to nation building here?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. First of all, it's of course about economics. So in the 30s, with the collectivization of agriculture, you have this focus on cotton as a product. And this made Uzbekistan very much dependent on cotton growing in its exchanges with the Soviet center. And I regard it as some kind of contract between the center and the periphery, that the center was investing in forms of money, in forms of materials, but also in forms of machines and experts. And the periphery was paying back with this raw cotton. So this was a very basic economic contract, and Uzbekistan was often called the Soviet cotton base. But you also mentioned these pictures, and I think that's also important that in terms of the mental framing of the Uzbek nation, and also the aesthetic framing and cultural framing. When you think of the Uzbek pavilion on the exhibition in Moscow that I showed, and everywhere you have this cotton symbols that are really like, everyday, in everyday usage, and very much connected to the imagery of Uzbekistan. And when you go to the late Soviet period, you see that experts were really experiencing really a hard time with this economic decline in the post in the late Soviet era period, and with these reports about cotton numbers, cotton figures, harvests being made up. There was a big cotton scandal in the 80s. And they were really experiencing like pain. One of them addressed this as, you know, the national pride of Uzbekistan. This is cotton production and our national pride is hurt. So here you see, I think, how much this cotton thing was central to the Uzbek national identity.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, as of now, we don't have any additional questions. So I guess I wanted to connect to this last answer and ask you also about the impact of religion. You didn't mention that a lot. I guess this also had an impact. So what was the stance of traditional, maybe as in the case of Europe, religious communities on this, introduction of new technologies, of new colonizing efforts by the Russian Empire? So where do you see a connection here?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a good question, but I have to say I didn't really study this. When you look at the literature that is existing on Uzbekistan, on Central Asia, you see that a lot of it is devoted to culture, to language, and to religion. When I started my project long ago, I talked to Adib Khalid and he said, yeah, we have to do this kind of stuff, like cotton growing. This is really something down to earth. And we were just studying, you know, all the cultural things, but we have missed so far these very like hardcore economic technical things. I'm not a real expert on Islam and so on. But I didn't find, let's put it like this, I didn't find traces of major resistance of Islamic Muslim communities against irrigation. And then I also didn't find traces of peasant resistance. I mean, you have much resistance in the 30s against collectivization. That's very clear, and there are a lot of sources on this. But I think irrigation was something that everybody welcomed, because peasants profited from this. It was always clear, and you also have Central Asian sayings about this, you know, that water is a rich water. One who is at the head of the canal is the lucky one, and so on. So I don't think there were much grounds to really resist these kinds of modernization. When it comes to gender or some other topics, of course, it's different. But in this area, I don't think there was much resistance on religious grounds.
So would you say that the project in Uzbekistan is basically also a typical development project of the Soviet Union? Or is it, would you say it's apart from the more general pattern?
Yeah, I think it's typical. And there is a book by Artemy Kaninovsky about development in Soviet Tajikistan. And he shows that even the debates, not only what was really going on in these republics, but also the debates, that they're very, very much connected to international global debates on development. For example, manual work and machines, the question of women's work. Should women work in the house or in the in industry, and so on and so on? And there are quite a few examples that show that you can, via this notion of development, you can connect Soviet discussions with the more international trends, so to say.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's really interesting. I'm sure there's more to do research on in this field.
Yeah. And I mean, I'm talking about Uzbekistan all the time, I did something on Turkmenistan, but less. I was in the archives in Uzbekistan, but not in Turkmenistan. And I know there's a PhD student in Ohio. He's starting a project on cotton in Tajikistan now. This is also very important. And in general, I think there will be more research on other republics, on other aspects of these topics. And yeah, I understood my work myself as some, you know, to open up these topics. And I don't expect it to conclude research on this.
Yeah, and as we know, we have the Water in Central Asia initiative here also at the University of Pittsburgh. So are there any more questions from the audience, maybe from this group? I don't see that now. You can also raise your hand and then you can ask your question in person if you want. So I think there's nothing on the Q&A right now. Is that just my Q&A? Yeah, if that's not the case, any last second questions? Yeah, if that's not the case, yeah, thank you so much, Julia, for joining us today. And as you all know, this talk has been recorded, so you'll get an information of where to retrieve it. Again, I hope this was enlightening for all of you, and I hope you will join us again with your new project as soon as it is kind of far farther advanced, and it's really seems to be a very interesting way of combining global history and also the history on the ground, combining micro histories with the global, something that historians are looking for right now. And yeah, thank you again. And also I like to thank the audience for doing this, and especially Sarah Passerini from the Center of Eastern European and Eurasian Studies for setting this whole presentation up. Okay, thank you all and have a good day.